give it just a minute to get. Okay, I can give you a wave back there when you start.
Okay.
Good afternoon and welcome. Thank you so much for coming to our piano and organ recital. Karen and I are sharing the bill here for an afternoon of non-church music, classical and some contemporary. And so we're very excited about performing for you, and I hope you will enjoy our presentation. I've got a few words to say before. I'm going to give a little bit of background on each of the pieces that I'm going to play. Karen will do the same. And so we're going to start with Bach. And Johann Sebastian Bach was a composer of the Baroque era. He was active in the early 1700s to mid, he died in 1750, so he was active in the early 1700s, and he was a member of a very well-known musical family in Germany. He had generations of musicians before him, but he really became the kind of the culmination of all of those, and brought together many different kinds of styles and history of music up until that point. And one thing that I didn't know in doing the research for this little bit of background is that Bach was an organ builder. I knew he was an organist. He was well known during his time as a proficient organist, harpsichordist, and the piano as we know it today did not exist in Bach's time. It may have just been invented around the time that he was active. But he did not compose specifically for the piano. But the fact that he was an organ builder and a consultant on to other folks who were organ builders, I found very, very interesting. Bach has written many, many works, and many of which are would be well known to you, such as the Brandenburg Concertos, the Well-Tempered Clavier, which is a work for keyboard, the Mass in B minor, many, many church works, and many secular works as well. Every piano student, at least every piano student that I know of, learns Bach. Bach wrote some relatively easy pieces that beginning piano students learn, and also many recitals start with Bach, and so we decided that would be a good way to start this afternoon's recital. So I'm going to play the first movement of Bach's Concerto in the Italian style. Thank you. I'm going to change gears a little bit here, and we're going to switch to some ragtime by Scott Joplin. Scott Joplin is the preeminent ragtime composer. There were a few others, and there were others mainly in his time, which was he was active in the late 1800s, early 1900s, and he grew up in Texarkana and had the good fortune of studying with a German music teacher who happened to live in Texarkana and heard Scott Joplin play as a young boy. And the name of that German music teacher is lost to history at this point, but Joplin learned the classics, went to operas with this person, and just had a great background in the classics. And in addition, he grew up in he was black, and he grew up in a segregated South, and was exposed to church music and spirituals and folk music, and he was able to combine all of these influences into his ragtime compositions. He did not enjoy great success during his lifetime. He did have a measure of success, but there was always a kind of a disreputable air about ragtime at the time, because it came out of black segregated communities, and so there was a somewhat of a stigma about it. But he persisted, nevertheless, and in 1899 he wrote what may be his most well-known ragtime, which is Maple Leaf Rag, and became rather famous at that point. The ragtime I'm going to play is called Weeping Willow. That's from 1903, so a few years later he had some measure of success, and Weeping Willow is one of a group of ragtimes that were composed around that time that were very song-like, and I've been playing this one for a while, and I've thought it just sounds like there should be lyrics for this ragtime. It's very very enjoyable. I would like to just read a quote from H. Wiley Hitchcock, who was a famous musicologist, in describing Joplin's music: elegant, varied, often subtle, and as sharply incised as a cameo. Lovely, powerful, infectious, and moving. And so I hope you enjoy. This is Weeping Willow.
switch instruments here. This piece is by Charles Vigor. He was a French organist, composer, and teacher, and had a career spanning like 8 decades. Actually kept his dexterity in hand until he retired when he was 90. Now, wouldn't that be nice? But along the way, he did 10 symphonies for organ and also composed for other instruments and voice and piano. He was quite a master of improvising. And in fact, he was often challenged to improvisational duels by other great organists who were good improvisers as well, like César Franck and Gabriel Fauré. So imagine, if you will, dueling banjos, and then think about dueling pipe organs, and the walls came tumbling down. So this is the finale from Symphony No. 2 by Vigor.
Thank you.
And now for something in a little bit lighter vein. This is called St. George's Gallop. And it always makes me think of a chase. So you can picture George just galloping along on horseback and feeling good and enjoying the view, stopping for a while, and suddenly realizing he's being followed by somebody with ill intent. So he gets to going a little faster. He has to climb a huge mountain or hill with them behind him. He has to sneak around their campfire at night. And finally he gets away and he gallops off to his freedom. So this is St. George's Gallop by Simon Peberty. Thank you.
Karen and I are going to play an organ and piano duet now of Tchaikovsky. Peter Ilyich Tchaikovsky, probably the most famous Russian composer of all time, has written many works that many people are familiar with. He's known for writing popular, almost popular melodies that just have become very well known and very enjoyed. For instance, the Nutcracker Suite is one that you may be familiar with, and the 1812 Overture, two very famous pieces by Tchaikovsky. He's been described as writing tuneful, open-hearted melodies, impressive harmonies, and colorful, picturesque orchestrations. I find Nutcracker is one of my favorite pieces of any composer, and I find that description to be very, very apt, particularly the orchestrations. So we're going to play an arrangement of the slow movement from his fifth symphony, the Andante Cantabile, arranged for organ and piano.
Thank you.
Okay, now I'm going to play some Brahms. Brahms was a contemporary of Tchaikovsky, at least for part of his life. But while Tchaikovsky was writing kind of almost pop-like tunes, you know, tuneful and enjoyable and accessible melodies, Brahms was a little bit more in the traditional kind of late classical, early romantic style. So more of kind of sticking to form and a little bit more almost reserved. But one thing about Brahms is even though his music may sound reserved, there is almost always an undercurrent of deep, deep emotion. He struggled in his personal life. I don't believe he was ever married. He had a couple of relationships, but that didn't work out. But his feeling, and he expressed this as well, is that he really can only express himself through music. So his music does really, to me, have this very strong undercurrent of deep, deep emotion. I'm going to play three intermezzos from Opus 119, which were relatively late in Brahms' career. Intermezzos in classical form were used as kind of in-between pieces, so in between acts of an opera or a ballet. But Brahms wrote many, many piano works where he collected intermezzos. He called them intermezzos. They're short, relatively short pieces that form a kind of a unified whole. So Opus 119 actually includes a rhapsody at the end, which I'm not going to play, but I will play the first three pieces of that work, which are three intermezzos. Thank you.
Thank you.
Brahms is hard. I'm going to play another Scott Joplin ragtime. This one is called The Favorite. This one is from a little bit later. It's from 1904. Joplin was, I mentioned that he had been exposed to opera. He had tried his hand at writing opera, actually. He wrote a couple. The one, he was working on one, and the name escapes me at the moment, at the time, around 1903, 1904, that didn't really come to anything. For a variety of reasons, his agent, his publisher, other reasons, it just, it didn't happen. He did write an opera later on, Treemonisha, that did become well-known and one of his better-known works. So this is from around the period of his experimenting in opera. And so you may notice in this one, there's still, in the left hand, there's boom-chop, boom-chop, boom-chop. There's still a lot of that, but there's also other sections that are not like that, that are more orchestral almost. Kind of, I think that perhaps was an influence of some of his work on opera. So this is The Favorite.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I think I skipped the Debussy. I see, yes, my apologies. I'm going to play it now. I went right to the Joplin. So I'm going to play Debussy. So Debussy was composing in the late 1800s, early 1900s, contemporary actually of Joplin. But Debussy was an impressionist composer. He was part of the impressionist movement, which you may be familiar with artists, impressionist artists like Monet and Degas, that kind of, I think of the Monet water lilies and the kind of the watery, kind of flowing sort of look that those paintings have. Debussy's music is often like that, kind of flowing, watery sounding. And but he did have many interesting influences, one of which I found very interesting was French pantomime and circus, such as the characters of character of Pierrot, that Debussy was very influenced by. Not so much in this piece that I'm going to play. This is a standalone piece, so many of Debussy's piano works were multiple movements or parts of larger, like the Clair de Lune, which I've played before, is part of a larger suite of piano music. But Reverie stands on its own. It was composed in 1890, so kind of right in the middle of Debussy's career, and it's pretty well known. You may recognize it. So this is Debussy's Reverie.
Thank you.
move on to Gustav Holst. Now, he was an English composer who wrote this orchestral suite called The Planets. He had a hard time writing longer orchestral pieces, but these short little suites seemed to agree with him. And he was very interested in astrology and horoscopes and the planets and what the nature of the planets was. This was kind of unusual at its time and a little controversial, but as time went by, it became quite well accepted and quite popular. So this is his mood piece, he called it Jupiter. This next piece is called Hornpipe Humoresque. And it's done that way for a reason. This is Noel Rawsthorn winking at you. He's quite a musician, and he knows a lot about music and its history. So he's giving you a piece that seems like a simple little hornpipe. But then he throws in the notes that are so wrong that they're just hilarious. And he'll quote little snippets of classic pieces. You'll hear a little bit of Vivaldi. You'll hear a little bit of Bach's, Brandenburg's. You'll hear a little bit of Vidor, even. But he'll always come back to the hornpipe. What can you say about John Williams? His music has become just part of the vernacular when it comes to anything to do with Hollywood. This particular little selection has some of the iconic pieces from Star Wars. So you'll recognize a lot of them and see the pictures in your head of Princess Leia, the haunting strains of her contemplating her future, and then the funky little weird cantina band. There'll be May the Force Be With You that has a sort of a foreshadowing of heavier things to come. than the huge and sinister and threatening Imperial March, and finally the triumphant Star Wars main theme.
Thank you. Thank you.